Well, good morning, and I hope you've had a good week. I hope that this week has been a time that you have been refreshed, and we're going to open right back up in Acts chapter 17. So if you want to take your Bible, and let's go into Acts 17, verse 10. What we've seen is we've seen Paul and Silas has passed through another area, and they've made their way to Thessalonica, a very wealthy place. There was a synagogue there, and of course, what did they do? They preached Jesus. What was the result? Some believed, some got mad. They want to shut him up. They want to shut up Paul everywhere he goes. I think you're going to see that that pattern is going to persist. The gospel either moves you to Jesus or makes you want to run. As we have said many times, every time we've preached, every time we've had a service where the gospel has been preached, a decision has been made.
Absolutely.
It is either not right now, no, I don't want it, no, I'll never take it. A decision is always made, or yes, I want everything that God's got for me. So let's go on now into Berea. I never read this now where God's given me the privilege of several times to go preach in Berea, Kentucky. As you get ready to go into that little town, you know, you think about the book of Acts and this area called Berea. And the Bible says in Acts 17:10, "And the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews." And there it is again. They go to the synagogue. Verse 11, "These were more noble than those in Thessalonica in what they received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. Therefore, many of them believed, also of honorable women, which were Greeks, and of men, not a few." Let's take verses 10 through 12 and take the positives. We see that the gospel is now going into a new area, into Berea. And what we also see is that they received the word with readiness in mind. And I think this is one of the great takeaways that we take out of this. If you've ever studied Acts, this is always one of the key parts. They searched the scriptures.
Right.
When they heard somebody teach or heard somebody preach, they wanted to see, is it the truth?
Yeah.
Is this what the scriptures say, and is this what God meant? You know, Mark, it's fascinating to me how a lot of people now don't carry a Bible. Do you remember that as a kid? Everybody who got out of their car had a Bible in their hand.
Absolutely. I can remember going to church, especially on days where I would be, when my mom and dad were working, and I would go to church with my grandmother. And I don't know that there was ever a time that I went to that little country church. I mean, it's just country folks. They love Jesus. Just a sweet, sweet fellowship.
Yeah.
But every time you would walk in, everybody either had one up under their arm or they had it in their lap. You never looked out, and I've been back to that church, and there's still a great number of people that carry their Bible, but you can see there's a lot of people that don't carry their Bible.
Yeah, that's not a takeaway from some people using their phone and some people using an iPad. And we are in a different world technologically, but I just personally, I just have to have
it in my hands.
The book in my hands. Yeah. I'm also still, as you know, in the study, I think both of us are, we've learned to use the internet and go around and search commentaries and all those great software programs. But to me, there's always just something special about the book on the desk, and you're underlining something, you're highlighting something. And I love how this church, when they heard it, they searched the scriptures.
Absolutely.
You know, there's one thing I'd love to see. I love to see when I'm up preaching, I know you'd say the same thing. There's something so special about seeing people with the Bible open. They've got a notepad out, or you see them highlighting, and they're making notes.
Absolutely.
Yesterday, after I left, or excuse me, Sunday, after I left church, we went to where Hayden was being introduced and installed as a new student pastor, and the preacher did a great job breaking down a passage out of Philippians, and there's that verse in there, forgetting those things which are behind. And he said, don't forget to forget. And, you know, the Spirit of God would say, you need to remember that, because there's a lot of times we forget to forget. We just holding on to something. And so I wrote that in my Bible. I made sure to put that note. Something about writing it down, searching it out, makes you remember it better.
It makes it more personal. I mean, you're spending time searching the Scriptures, what they were doing in Berea here. They were digging to find truth.
Yeah.
And I think that, that goes to, I'm always encouraged if you're sharing your faith with somebody. And you can tell when the Spirit of God is at work on their end, because when you begin to talk to them and they say, well, all right, show me where that's at in the Scriptures.
Right, right.
And I see that as a playing out of the folks in Berea.
Yeah.
It is, okay, I hear what you're saying, but show me from the Word of God where it says that. And I think as a person sharing their faith, or even as a preacher, man, you ought to be sitting there going, all right, God's at work here. God's going to do something, because they're open. They're open to the idea of, let's open up the Bible together. Yeah. Let's look what the Bible has to say.
Right.
And then I believe the Spirit of God will do what He needs to do.
Absolutely. When Alex was a child, and Sunday after Sunday would walk down the aisle, she would come forward and she wanted to be saved above all things. But it hadn't really come that time yet when the Spirit of God knocked. Well, we was in the parsonage there in Georgia, and that night, man, God was really working on Alex's heart. And I remember we went into her bedroom, and I sat down and I was talking her through it, and I'd say, honey, the Bible, you know, God says this and in the Bible, and she would say, show me. And boy, you know, that's something. Even though I'm a pastor, I've got the Bible out. She wanted to see it in print.
Yep.
I just think there's a beautiful thing. Yeah, show me in print. The Bible is the living, powerful Word of God. The Bible is sharper than a two-edged sword. And folks, when we're listening to somebody teach, when we are taking in preaching, even though they're trustworthy sources, we may be following people we know are biblical, but listen, we need to search the Scriptures and say, is that Bible? And while we're listening. So we admire them for that. And many of them believe. Verse 12, there we go again. Notice there's always a synagogue, seems like. There is always a group that believes. And there's always going to be a group who continues to follow and cause problems.
Yeah, there's always a verse 13. It says, but when the Jews of Thessalonica had knowledge that the word of God was preached of Paul at Berea, they came thither also and stirred up the people. Now, this is what we need to understand. This is not necessarily the people who were in Berea.
Yeah.
I mean, Paul and Silas had went there, preached the gospel. These folks had searched the Scriptures. They were making decisions for Christ, repenting of their sins and trusting Christ as Savior and Lord. And word gets back to Thessalonica, where Paul and Silas have just left.
Yeah.
And they'd left the city in a ruckus, basically. And all of a sudden, these folks say, oh, well, we're going to make sure that we go on over to Berea, and we're going to start to cause some problems there. And it says in verse 14, and then immediately the brethren sent away Paul to go, as it were, to the sea, but Silas and Timothy abode there still. So we see, again, that same pattern of they preach the gospel. There are people that will respond positively and trust in Christ as Savior and Lord. And then there are those who get angry, get bitter, get mad, and are moved to really action in a negative way, where they're going to try to either arrest Paul and Silas and all that were with him, or taking it to the extreme, they wanted them dead.
Right, right. And that's the thing. Everywhere Paul went, he was considered the main troublemaker.
Right. Yeah.
Because look, Silas and Timothy were able to still stay. They didn't see. They were not the bigger threat. But Paul certainly was. And you know, we all brag on Paul, as we should. Paul should be lifted up high in the church, not as high as Jesus, but he certainly should be admired. But please, folks, we got to remember, studying the Scripture, the price this man paid.
Yeah.
When God picked Paul, when he put his hand on him and used him, and he gave his heart to Jesus, there was no turning back for him. There was no going back to any other way of life And the fact of the matter is, he paid an ultimate price.
I think with Paul too, don't you think if the means of how God arrested his heart,
yeah,
and brought him to salvation, I think Paul was constantly at war with the fact of his past, and he kept thinking, God, I've got to do more.
Yeah.
I've got to, not as far as he was doing it based on works.
Yeah.
He knew it wasn't his works that was going to get him into heaven. He knew that it was his relationship with Christ, but I guarantee you, being a man, he constantly was thinking about, my goodness, because I know how I am. I'm constantly thinking about things that happened years ago,
yeah,
in my past, and I'm thinking, God, thank you for your grace and for your mercy for those things and forgiving me for them, but I got to do more. I got to try to do more for the kingdom of God, and I think that's what propelled him, and that's why so many times we see him so consumed,
yeah,
with the gospel. He is just so passionate about what had happened in his past, and because of that, he was adamant about telling people about Jesus.
Yes, he was. And that fire that was lit did not easily go out with Paul. It never went out. I think it grew and grew and grew. Mm. Now, the Bible says in verse 15, they that conducted Paul brought him to Athens. So we see a move of Paul into yet another place. And as we study the book of Acts, it's good for us to take note that moving place to place also meant that the gospel of Jesus moved place to place,
yep,
and more people would receive it. And the Bible says there in verse 15 at the end, and receiving a commandment unto Silas and Timothy for to come to him with all speed, they departed. Now, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, verse 16, you almost can see his heart broken.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to wonder, what would Paul think sitting in New York? Mm. What would Paul think sitting in San Francisco?
Yeah.
Or
in
Waynesville?
Yeah.
What would he think sitting in our cities?
Yeah.
That it seemed to him, the whole city, they were given over completely to idolatry.
Yeah.
Mark, what would be what is a good way of looking at idolatry? What is it?
Well, it's literally when I remember we took the kids through a study. I believe it was by Kyle Idleman.
Yeah.
And it was called Gods at War. Mm. Was the title, mm-hmm, of the series. And literally, what his definition of idolatry, I believe, if I remember correctly, was anything in our life that we place above God and God's position of preeminence in our life.
So our wife, our husband, our children, our,
yeah,
jobs,
yeah,
our sports teams. You know, when you really shape idolatry down, and I agree with your assessment of that, and the teaching of that is right on. Idolatry is putting anything
ahead of God.
Ahead of God.
Yeah.
You know, and when Paul saw this in the city, they were given to idolatry.
Yeah.
How about reading those verses that follow?
All right, so we'll pick up there in verse 17. It says, therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons, and in the market daily with them that met with him. Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him, and some said, what will this babbler say? Others, some, he seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preached unto them Jesus and the resurrection. And they took him and brought him unto the Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is. And Just as a side note there, as we move into this, because this is a great, great passage of Scripture where we see Paul just his wisdom and his discernment and his conviction to preach. But the Areopagus is a place where they would go, and they literally had a multiplicity of gods. It was basically known as Mars Hill. Yeah. We'll read that here in a minute. But it literally was a hillside that was scattered with all kinds of idols. And so let's pick back up there. Verse 20, "For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know therefore what these things mean. For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear of some new thing." And then, verse 22, it says, "Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said," now this is one of the most powerful statements that Paul ever makes in Scripture. He said, "You men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious. For I passed by, and behold, your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you.'" So basically what was going on is they're taking Paul to this hillside where they have a great number of idols set up. And that was one of the things in Athens. There was a lot of idol worship.
Yeah.
And they go to this particular area. And Paul is a perceptive guy. When I think of Paul, I think of a guy that nothing got by him. He saw a lot of things, and he was quick on his feet. I think of a man that has quick wit, and just very educated, and he didn't miss anything at all. And so he sees this statue that basically says, "To the unknown God." And he turns to the crowd and he said, "You know, you've got this statue up here that's got this inscription on it. And obviously, you think you know what you're doing up here, but I'm going to proclaim to you the one that you don't know." And man, he launches into a gospel presentation for the ages.
Yeah.
And there he is on a hillside with all of the idols that Athens could offer. And you've got the man of God standing in the middle, boldly proclaiming that all of these idols are dead, are useless, because there's one God. And he has demonstrated his love for you in the sending of his own son to die on the cross for your sins.
Yeah, you know, if you back up in verse 18, we have the Epicureans and we have the Stoics.
Stoics, right.
Epicureans, and the Stoics were the dominant philosophers,
right.
You know, and yet they're the dominant philosophers, but they had a difference in opinion.
Yeah.
Epicureans were live for the now, live for pleasure.
Pleasure.
The Stoics were like, no.
Kind of like the monks, avoid pleasure.
Avoid
at all costs.
Pleasure. If you're having fun, then something's wrong.
Yeah.
Both of them are missing it badly.
Yeah, absolutely.
If you don't have that balance, and the only way you can balance it is through the life of the Lord Jesus.
Absolutely.
Well, then Paul walks in, and they said, "Well, what do you think this babbler will say?"
Yeah.
And yet, when he opens his mouth and he begins to proclaim Jesus, you know, there's something that we need to apply here. There's power in the name of Jesus.
Yeah, absolutely.
We can sing it, but it's so true. And there is. There's power in the name of Jesus.
Yeah,
and when we stand and we proclaim the Word of God, when we teach Scripture, when we are in the Scriptures, it empowers us. It gives us what we need. But there is a power in the gospel. Yeah. There's a power in proclaiming Jesus as the only way. I can tell you in preaching that it's... you feel it.
Yeah, absolutely.
You feel a boldness because you know that what John has to say has no power on it. My ideas, my thoughts are very, very, very little value. But when we say the Bible says, there's such an authority that goes with that.
Absolutely.
And when we say the Lord Jesus says, Jesus said this. I love when I am preaching to say, I didn't say this.
Yeah, this is
I
him.
Didn't write this.
This is him.
This was him. He said this, and you know, that's the authority that we have to stand on, and here they are, they're calling him a babbler, and look, they don't know any better because they're worshiping false gods anyway.
Yeah.
They don't have no idea.
Exactly.
And it's Paul's job, it's his task to relay unto them the truth of the one that they're really looking for, and they even said... verse 19, they brought him to Mars Hill, or as you said,
right.
And they said, "May we know what this new doctrine is.
Yeah, they just basically wanted to add the teachings of Christianity to the smorgasbord of all the different idols that were on the hillside.
Like the bumper sticker that we see with all the world religion coexist.
Yeah, that's basically what they were doing. We'll take a little of Jesus, but we're going to put Jesus up here on the same pedestal as the Epicureans and the Stoics and the philosophers of the day, Plato, Aristotle, all those. We're going to put all that stuff up here on this hillside for people to just pick and choose a little here
buffet.
And there. A little buffet, a little spiritual buffet for people to get what they want. And what Paul so boldly does is he comes in and he wrecks it all. He comes in and he says, you know what? You guys are up here worshiping these things carved by human hands, and I'm going to tell you, God's not in it.
Right.
God's not in it at all. And matter of fact, I'm going to point out to you the fact that it says that I'm going to use this one that you've got here, place that says to the unknown God.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of truth in that because you don't know Him. He longs to know you, but you don't know Him personally. And if you knew Him, you'd realize that all this other junk on this hillside is just that.
Yeah.
Junk.
It's just junk.
Yeah.
And I'm glad I don't have junk, aren't you? I've mm-hmm. got the truth. Let's pick it up now and let's see as we close today's time together. Let's hear what He told them. And the Bible says, let's look at verse 22. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, "Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you're too superstitious." And Mark read this a minute ago, but let's take note of it again. "I passed by and behold your devotions."
Yeah.
I'm watching you. Yeah. "I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore you ignorantly worship, Him I declare unto you. God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that He is Lord of heaven and earth, dwells not in temples made with hands.
Yeah.
Neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though He needed anything, seeing He giveth to all life and breath and all things. He's made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth. He's determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord if happily they might feel after Him and find Him, though He be not far from every one of us. For in Him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also His offspring. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought to not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone, graven by art and man's device. And the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commendeth all men were everywhere to repent, because He has appointed a day in the which He will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom He's ordained, whereof He hath given assurance unto all men, in that He raised Him from the dead. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, and others said, We will hear thee again of this matter. So Paul departed from among them. Howbeit, certain men clave unto Him and believed. Among them was Dionysius, the Arabicite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. You know, there's one thing that we need to see. Paul was prepared.
Yeah.
Everywhere he went, he had studied Scripture his whole life, but he didn't know the God of Scripture.
Right.
When he knew the God of Scripture, he didn't cease to study. He started preparing from a different angle. He saw it from a different viewpoint. Mm. But here we cannot deny this. He was always ready to give an answer for what was in him. He was always prepared to stand in front of any group, no matter what their belief, whether it be an Epicurean who said, eat, live, and be merry, and be happy.
Yeah.
That probably the Nike slogan would fit an Epicurean, just do it.
Right.
Whether it be a Stoic who says no, and they are exactly what their name, very Stoic. You shouldn't smile like a lot of churches. There's no joy.
Right.
Because if we have joy, that's not of God, and that's unreasonable. There's great joy in knowing God. But he was prepared. Paul was always ready to stand up and talk with anybody around the fishermen who had very little knowledge of Jesus or around the most studied philosopher. Paul was always ready.
Yeah, absolutely.
And he always had the same message. It's all about Jesus. Yeah. He's the one you're looking for. If you boil down every message of Paul, you'll start seeing that. Here's what you're really looking for.
Yeah.
And did you notice at the end, Mark, that it said some didn't believe?
Yeah, some claved.
They mocked.
Yeah.
Some said, we'll listen to you again.
Yeah.
And some said, we got to stay with you.
Absolutely.
We got to cleave to you because we need to hear the truth of what's going on. And guys, today, as we hold our Bible, we said this in Tuesday's Bible study, this is the truth of every meeting of God's people, every time we get together. Some people say, that's ridiculous. Some people say, I'd like to hear a little more of that. And some people say, I'm sticking to that.
Yeah.
I want more of that. Not only do I want to hear more of it, I believe it, and I want as much as I can get. I want to receive as much as possible. And, you know, thank God for that. We're still proclaiming the same message of Paul, and there are still people making those decisions.
Amen. And I can't help but think about God's sovereign plan when it comes to this particular passage. He knew that these two folks would be in that general area.
Yeah.
He sent his servant Paul to preach the truth on a hill full of idols, and you got two people, a man and a woman, who hear the gospel.
Yeah.
And we are given their names here in Scripture. But you know what else? Their names were written down that day.
Absolutely.
In the Lamb's Book of Life.
Amen.
And I'm grateful that God knew what they needed, sent his man their direction.
Yeah.
The gospel was preached, and God's word will never, ever, ever return void.
Amen. And guys, today, remember this. Our message will always receive a mixed reaction.
Yeah.
You know, it's always going to, some believed, some laughed, some kept searching for more information. And, you know, Mark, I just want people to know today as we study this, let's not hesitate to tell others about Jesus.
Amen.
You know, even though it may come with hostility and even though it might come with problems, there's still going to be some people curious and some people want to hear more.
Yeah, we'll never know how many people have come along. You know, I think it was Paul that talked about, or some of the folks when they were talking about how Paul watered or Apollos watered Paul, you know, those kind of things in Scripture.
Yeah.
We never know how many people have been by and watered a gospel seed that's been planted in someone's life. And it may very well be that when we share the gospel, God brings that seed to fruition,
right,
and we reap the harvest. And it's a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
It really is. So like you said, I think we always ought to be ready. Scripture tells us that. 1 Peter tells us we ought to be ready always to give an answer for the hope that we have in Christ.
Right.
And so with gentleness and meekness, what the Scripture says there. And so we ought to be ready to tell people about who Jesus is, because we just don't know how many times that seed has been watered, and it may be ripe for the picking.
And only if only a few believe, it's still worth the effort.
Absolutely,
and, you know, I'm so excited every time somebody gets saved and get to look out and see how God's transforming that life and transforming that family. And you may have 1,000 reject it and 10,000 laugh at it, but when that one comes to repentance, man, all of heaven rejoices.
Amen.
Well, we love you today. Thank you for being with us in Moments with the Master and spending time around God's Word. Come Tuesday, Lord willing, we'll crack open our Scriptures again and we'll study the 18th chapter of the book of Acts. Praying that you that watch, if you're not a member of Calvary Road, then whatever church you attend, I just pray the best service you can possibly have come this Sunday, this Lord's Day. There's a lot going on in our world. We see fires, we've seen storms, hurricanes, we're seeing all kind of issues going on, but I tell you, I still hear the words of our King.
Yes.
Look up, for our redemption draweth nigh.
Amen.
Can't wait to see you in God's house Sunday. We love you, and God bless you. Well, thanks for being with us in worship today. It is our heart's desire that through the Word and through this worship service today, God has spoken to your heart.
and you desire to serve Him and to worship Him more than you ever have in your life. You know, if you've been watching today and you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, that is our greatest desire. If we can be a help to you, if we can assist you in any way, please contact us at the information you see on the screen. We also want to thank those of you who watch us regularly. We greatly appreciate your prayer and support. Keep praying for us as we pray for you, as we serve the Lord together.